Hi, I'm Florent Lassalle. I work at the Wellcome Sanger Institute in the group of Nick Thompson. And today I will present you our study about the genomic epidemiology of the cholera outbreak that took place in Yemen and how we found that a succession of epidemic clones was driven by the acquisition of a multi-drug resistance plasmid. So then, in Yemen, in 2016, a cholera outbreak was declared. So this followed the start of a very large humanitarian crisis that was induced by the war that started in 2015. And this outbreak was called the worst cholera outbreak in the world. And those are the words of the WHO. And this refers to the fact that it is the largest ever recorded outbreak in recorded history. And so it started in 2016 with the first wave, which is comparatively small, but with respect to standards of outbreaks in other parts of the world, this already will be like a quite large outbreak. And then it dwindled, and then in 2017 there was like the next wave, which peaked at 50,000 cases per week. And then there was a continuous wave up to 2020. So it also continued in 2021 and 2022, but with apparently like reduced cases number, but that wasn't recorded because of the COVID crisis. And so up to 2020, there were 2.5 million suspected cases, and this led to almost 4,000 related deaths. A quarter of the cases were in children under 5, and this is dramatic because those children are really sensitive to dehydration and may have sequelae later in their life. So, regarding this outbreak, a first study was published in 2019, and so this study, led by François Xavier and other members of our team, Marie-Laure, Nick, and so on. Depicts the genomic epidemiology of the first 2 years of the outbreak in Yemen, so 2016-2017. This study was based on 42 isolates collected from cholera patients. And if you remember what I presented in the other talk about methodologies, this is a good example, again, of using the reference-based approach to look at the diversity of epidemic Vibrio cholerae of the seven pet lineage. And so, like the study of the events of introduction of cholera into Africa, this one found that all Yemen isolates grouped into a single clade. That is a group of branches that emerges from the diversity of South Asian isolates. And actually, the isolates from Yemen actually emerge from the diversity of East African isolates that themselves emerge from the diversity of South Asian isolates. So, indicating a two-step introduction from Southeast Asia into East Africa and then into Yemen. And so that is why this lineage is called T13, as it's the 13th transmission into Africa, then following into Yemen. And so it shows that there was a single introduction of the epidemic 7 pet strain. So that's again like a wave 3 sublineage T13 7 pet strain. And this was the only source of the outbreak over the years 2016-2017. So, moving on to 2018-2019. So, as I said previously, antimicrobials are used to manage cases during the outbreak. And so, in Yemen, doxycycline was used to treat the majority of patients. But then, like a third nearly a third of patients, so specifically pregnant women and children, were treated with macrolide drugs, such as azithromycin and erythromycin. And that was up to 2019, because in late 2018, early 2019, the team in SANAR observed a change of antimicrobial resistance profile of the Vibrio cholerae strains that were isolated from the stool samples. And that changed from being mostly susceptible to relevant drugs to multiple drug resistant. So you can see below that the previous strain in 2016 up to late 2018 was only resistant to nalidixic acid, whereas the strain observed from 2019 onwards was resistant to many different classes of antibiotics, including beta-lactams, and that would be like second-generation cephalosporins, and macrolides, and sulfonamides. And so what led to this change? It's an important question, because we want to know if a new strain has been introduced in the country that could bring its own new set of virulence factors, and so like potentially a new kind of disease. Or is it the same strain that acquired resistance determinants, typically borne by a plasmid, or other form of mobile genetic elements? So those are pseudo-autonomous bits of DNA that replicate in bacterial cells. And so to answer this question and to try and inform the public health surveillance and policies based on that, we conducted this genomic epidemiology study on the 2018 and 2019 isolates. So this is the flowchart of how we assembled data for this study. And so you see at the top like the three main collaborating institutes for this study and what was done over there. So this is very complex, I'm not going to go into the details, but shortly, like, data samples were collected in Yemen in hospitals across the country and then sent to NCPHL, where Vibrio cholerae strains were isolated and then characterized for phenotypes. And then samples of either strain cultures or only genomic DNA were sent to the Institut Pasteur and the Wellcome Sanger Institute. So the samples that were collected in hospitals in Yemen, so they were collected in 8 out of the 21 governorates. And so in 2018 and 2019, we obtained 6,000 and 3,000 clinical samples were collected and sent to NCPHL. And out of these, above 2,000 samples each year were confirmed to be Vibrio cholerae 01 by culture. So that would be culture. Firstly, enrichment in alkaline peptone water, and then culture on CCBS medium. And so you can see that while at the bottom, those samples that were not Vibrio cholerae, it's fairly even distribution, suggesting there is a background of contamination by other organisms. So maybe like patients that presented with diarrhea that wasn't caused by Vibrio cholerae, or where it failed to be isolated. But then if you look at the top, you have like two peaks, one in spring 17, and then two other peaks, one in late summer 2018, and then spring 2019. So matching the waves, the peaks of the waves of the epidemic based on suspected cholera cases, so that's a good confirmation that we were really observing the cause of the outbreak. And so this is looking at what was done in Yemen. So out of those two sets of 2000 samples and confirmed cultures of Vibrio cholerae, 250 samples were selected randomly to represent the various governorates and times of sampling, and so strains were isolated from those samples. In addition to that, 10 water samples had been taken from SANA sewage system in 2018, sorry. And again, strain were isolated from those samples. And so those strains, isolates, were then subjected to phenotyping tests, including antibiotic susceptibility testing, but also different types of biotyping and serotyping to detect if it were Inaba or Ogawa serotype of Vibrio cholerae 01. And then genomic DNA samples were produced, and that's what was sent to the Wellcome Sanger Institute. So, looking at the results of the antibiotic susceptibility testing done at the NCPHL, I've grouped here by different classes of antibiotic. You can see that so in brown is when the strains were found to be resistant, and blue were found to be sensitive, and in beige is when that class of antibiotic wasn't tested at that time on the strain. And what we can see is that there is a defined moment where there's a switch to the multi-drug resistant MDR profile, and that's in November 2018, where strains become resistant to beta-lactams, macrolides, and sulfonamides. And so you've got to sort of discount the bit in the top left where beta-lactams are resisted to in 2017, because it was only resistant to amoxicillin, not to second and third generation cephalosporins such as cefotaxime. And so you really can see the transition for the sulfonamide drugs, where testing for this susceptibility was done throughout the whole sampling effort. And so you can see when it switches, and that correlates with the other drugs. And so finally, we can notice that there is resistance to quinolones throughout the outbreak, but that's only resistance to nalidixic acid, not to ciprofloxacin, even though there is reduced sensitivity to ciprofloxacin, so it can't be used as a single dose treatment, but it still can be used. There's also resistance to nitrofurans, and so like both resistance to nalidixic acid and nitrofurans were already noticed in the previous report in the Nature paper, and so that's all, that's still true. And finally, we can see that tetracyclines are effective, so all isolates are sensitive to tetracycline and doxycycline, and that's what's being used as a last line antibiotic basically in the hospitals in Yemen. And so those 260 isolates that were subjected to testing, extended susceptibility testing and biotyping, and for which we had genomic DNA. So again, they were sent to Wellcome Sanger Institute and sequenced using the Illumina sequencing platform. And so from those genomic short-read sets, we obtain, after quality control and filtering, we obtain 232 high-quality genome assemblies. That's what's going to be used in the approach ones that I outlined previously. And then we also had a bit more short-read sets of good quality, so 241 that will be used for approach two. In parallel of that, 120 cultures were sent at Institut Pasteur, to Institut Pasteur, of which only 20 cultures could be revived upon receipt. And so from there, 21 isolates were obtained because there was one mixed culture where two isolates were obtained. And so they obtained 21 short read sets that were then studied together with the read sets obtained at the Sanger Institute. Even though they come from the same sample originally, we decided to treat them as separate isolates because of the potential for mixed cultures. And indeed, we saw several cases where the strains for which you obtain a genome at Sanger and the strains cultured and sequenced at Pasteur were different while coming from the same sample. And we'll come back to that. And so, looking at the genome assemblies, so that's for the approach one, so this is an agnostic approach. This is because at that point, we don't know what are those strains we sequence. Like, we just know that they are Vibrio cholerae, but we don't know what kind of strains, and for that sake, we need to have this core genome approach that allows to compare potentially divergent strains. And so, we studied these 232 assemblies in the context of a broader dataset taken from previous studies and public databases. And so this included Vibrio cholerae isolate genomes of a global and historical distribution, so aiming to cover the diversity of the species, including epidemic and endemic strains. And then we also focused our dataset on isolates that we knew to be related to the T13 sublineage, and so including some isolates from South Asia, East Africa, and then of course those from Yemen 2016-2017. And so we obtained this tree. So here you can see it's a tree that's represented as a circular tree, but like you can see the branches of the different clades, and so the different clades or groups are painted different colors. And so, and then you've got the outer ring that describes, in the case of isolates from Yemen 2018-2019, which governorates they were taken from. And so you can see, like, the big section of the tree in pink is a clade which I denominated VCH. So I just named them really like A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H. Like, so the red one is A and the pink one is H. And so this pink clade VCH is dominant in our dataset because typically it includes 216 of the out of the 232 isolates from Yemen 2018-2019. So that's the majority of those sampled in those last 2 years were from the VCH. And what we can see if we map this to that tree from the previous study, Doman et al., where you've got like another sort of nomenclature that's been used. So I presented you that tree before. So VCH corresponds to 7PET. So what we have here is like a dominance of 7PET isolates in our sample. However, we also have other kinds of isolates, and that includes those VCD isolates, so that's another kind of clade, and that we've got 21 of those, so it's quite a lot. Then we've got a few, two of the VCK that are related to isolates that have been known to occur in really small scale outbreaks, and typically in China. And those isolates are interesting because they are not toxigenic, but they do have the TCP virulence factor, so they are more prone to cause disease than other endemic strains, even though they are not the full epidemic. They don't have the full potential to cause epidemics. And then we've got like one very distant endemic isolate of the actually sister species, Vibrio paracholerae. And so again, like we've got four different clades that are represented, and three of them are in fact typically endemic strains, whereas like one VCH is 7 PET, and so the typical epidemic strain, that's the majority of the dataset. So now we know that, but so among those 7 PET isolates, we can ask, are those all identical, or is there some diversity? Because like we could have had reintroduction of a new strain that is also 7 PET, but that is not directly related to the one that was present in 2016, 2017. And so it's important to know like the fine detail of this relationship, because it could also tell us if the spread across space and time of the pathogen reflects its genetic diversification. And so for this, we're going to use that second approach I introduced earlier, which is the use of a high-resolution phylogenomic tree based on genome mapping. And so that's what we obtain here when we compare all those 7 PET isolates. So again, the outer ring represents those isolates from Yemen and documents there the governorate they were sampled from. So and other isolates that don't have anything in that outer ring come from different places, and typically East Africa at the top, 12 o'clock, and South Asia at the top left, sort of 10 o'clock. And so we can classify those strains in different subclades. So again, so here I call them phylogenetic clusters, to differentiate the scale of diversity. And so again, those are sections of the tree, so group of branches. And so in blue, at 10 o'clock, it's H9A, and then H9B, C, D, E, F, G, and H. And so in turquoise here, we've got H9G, and in pink, on the right-hand side, we've got H9H. And then at the top, in brown, it's E, and then the green khaki is F. And so those four groups represent all the Yemeni isolates. And you can see they still form a single clade, so a unique set of branches with a unique stem leading to it. And so that means they've got all a unique common ancestor. So indicating that we're still talking of a single introduction from typically stemming from the East African isolates. So introduction from East Africa into Yemen. So that's still the same scenario that was continued in 2 years, 2018, 2019. And so looking at the spatiotemporal distribution of those isolates, we have again VCH9E and F that were present in 2016 and 2017, with H9E that was dominant in both years. And then in the other years, you have H9H that was dominating 2018. And was only observed, one strain was observed of this clade in 2019, in March, as you can see at the bottom. Whereas H9G, in turquoise, was observed already in 2018, but in small numbers, and then dominated massively the year 2019. If you look at space distribution, we see that the distribution of those 7 PET isolates is well mixed over Yemen, and there was no statistical signal to say that there was a preferential distribution of certain clades in certain parts of the country. So that indicates that given the scale of the epidemic, of the outbreak anyway, that transmission was occurring too fast for a pattern of differentiation of those clones to occur. But what we have is a pattern of time differentiation suggesting that those different branches of the phylogeny, those phylogenetic clusters, seeded different waves of the epidemic. So like you first had the pink H9H that bloomed in 2018, and then its sister group of strains, like they were really like they emerged at the same time together, but the turquoise H9G waited somehow for 2019 to fully bloom into an epidemic wave. And so we can see like a significant statistically significant correlation between time of isolation and phylogenetic distance. And so that means that we can use the phylogenetic tree to actually estimate a time phylogeny. So instead of just like inferring the evolutionary relationships between these isolates, we will also try and time the diversification events of this phylogeny. And so that corresponds to estimating the date of emergence of clades in the tree, or in other words, to date the birth of the last common ancestors of those groups. And so here, like among other things, we can say that H9H and H9G, so again like the pink and the turquoise groups, both emerged in spring 2017, but then they dominated at different times, again like in 2018 and then 2019 respectively. Whereas their common ancestors then emerged in summer 2016, so during the first wave of the outbreak, and then took time to diversify and then seed the further waves. And so then the last common ancestor of all Yemeni 7-pet isolates, so 7-pet T13 isolates, is dated to winter 2015. So this is like the 95%. So that's the median estimate, but like the 95% confidence interval is actually fairly wide because it ranges from April 2014 to July 2015. And so we can ask ourselves if this corresponds to the date of introduction of this T13 lineage into Yemen, which will correspond more or less to the start of the humanitarian crisis. Now we can go back to the whole dataset and look at the pangenome. So as I said, like the pangenome, there are two parts. There's the core part that is shared by every isolate, so that's the big block of blue on the left. And then you've got the accessory part, which is like present in only a few isolates. And so when we face the presence absence, so present in blue, absent in white, with the tree of all isolates, we expect it to make blocks. And so if you have like a sparse distribution, such as those that are framed in red here, that is like in different blocks, those are genes that are present in different lineages. And so that means that like they are most likely have been transferred horizontally between different lineages. So that means genes has been exchanged not via clonal reproduction, but via other means, and typically via conjugation of a plasmid. And so here, like what we observe in this first block red frame, like we have genes that accessory genes that correspond to a plasmid. And so we found that plasmid in a lot of isolates. And so that's INC replicon type plasmid. It's 140 kilobases long. And it's a typical INC plasmid for the backbone, which I will call the backbone, that's the section in blue. And then you've got one section that's inserted into that backbone, and that's actually like a transposon, or specifically a pseudo compound transposon, because it's bonded by IS26 elements, transposases. And it's 20 kilobases pair long. And it's what we call a genomic island as well, because it it has its own sort of identity and in particular content in terms of gene that it carries. And so this one is very clearly specialized into carrying antimicrobial resistance genes. So here you've got the detail of what's encoded in that 20 kilobase pair element. And so in bold, you have the genes that are involved in antimicrobial resistance. And so it explained below what it is. And so it includes aminoglycoside resistant genes, a very rare kind of beta-lactamase. So it's an extended spectrum beta-lactamase of the class PER7. And this confers resistance to second generation cephalosporins. I hope I'm correct here. And so that's including cefotaxime, I think. And then we also have like sulfonamide resistant genes, and importantly we have macrolide resistant genes, three genes for macrolide resistance. And so that explains the pattern of resistance to sulfonamides, azithromycin, and different kinds of beta-lactam drugs. And so, as I said, like there's an INC plasmid backbone, and so this is very quite conserved, meaning that like the same backbone, so that will be like the section from 3 o'clock round to 1 o'clock on this circle. The same genes, near identical, are observed in many other plasmids present in other Vibrio cholerae genomes from very distant outbreaks. It can be from China or other place in Africa. And the only part that's not really conserved in all those other plasmids is the MDR PCT, so the one that actually encodes the multidrug resistance. However, you can see, and so those blocks of color really indicate the presence of homologous sequences in other elements. It shows that like separate elements, not plasmids, but separate elements do carry some homology, but like we could not find in most of isolates known and sequence present in databases, there was almost no occurrence of like a full copy of this MDR PCT. I say almost none because there's one strain that actually had it, and I'll come back to that. And so now like we looked at the distribution of those two mobile elements, so like looking at the full plasmid, so that's represented here by those yellow bullets. And so when they're full, it means like we really observe them in the genome assemblies, but like when it's a hollow circle, we have evidence of the presence in the read sets, even though it wasn't correctly assembled. But we still know that it's there. And so we very interestingly observed that those elements, and so the brown is the MDR transposon, those elements, the plasmid and the MDR transposon on it, were present in many different lineages. Not only the 7 PET VCH, which is here collapsed at the bottom, so I'm not representing anymore the whole set of isolates, I've collapsed it. But we know here we've got like more than 200 isolates at the bottom in the pink edge section. And all of them from 2019 carry the plasmid. But on top of that, you have also a VCK isolate from 2019 as well that carry the plasmid with the transposon. And then we've got like VCD isolates that carry the plasmid. And so interestingly, they're not uniform, those VCD isolates. There's actually three different types. So here they're numerated by sequence type. So that's using marker genes. So those are a group of 7 core genes are used for molecular typing, and based on that, like we can attribute different sequence types. And so here we observe three different sequence types in this big VCD clade. and ST 1020 and ST 1498 both were carrying the plasmid with the MDR PST, whereas the ST 555 isolates, which were like the majority of the BCD, I think there were 18 of those isolates, they only carried the MDR PCT transposon, not the plasmid. And so that means that this MDR PCT is standalone, or rather, was in fact inserted in the chromosome, the second chromosome of the bacteria, instead of being present on a plasmid. And so the presence of this same mobile genetic elements, when I say the same, like the sequences are matching perfectly, apart from in two isolates out of more than 200, where you've got one nucleotide change each. So really, like those are really the same elements that have been transmitted across different genetic backgrounds, and this has happened very recently because, as you can see, like all those with the plasmid were isolated in 2019 in pink, or those ST555 were isolated in 2018. And so that there was no time for those elements to mutate separately and accumulate diversity. And so we can make hypotheses on how those elements were exchanged. And so we've got some good reasons to think that the MDR PCD was originally present in those endemic ST555 isolates, and from there jumped onto a plasmid that was then found into the 7-PET isolates. And then most likely from these 7-PET isolates, because of the really like huge scale of spread of those 7-PET isolates, we know that like they've been disseminated in potentially more than 1 million patients cases. Then, like from there, like they spilled over into different genetic backgrounds, and so those other kind of endemic strains, ST170, ST1020, ST1498. And so, looking at the ST555, the strains from Yemen, so like those in red in this tree, all cluster together. So those are the ST555, and then at the top you've got ST1498, and then at the bottom you've got ST1020. So those are the clade D tree, and then like in the gray area you've got the ST555. And so, as I said previously, there was one strain in the whole of like public databases that also featured the MDR PCT, and so that was the strain 338360, so that strain in blue, that was isolated from a returning traveler. So it was isolated in UK from someone who came back from India. So we assume it was acquired in India. And that strain is also of the sequence type 555 and carried the exact same copy of the MDR PCT, suggesting that the PCT is native of this genomic background. And that's why we assume, we make the hypothesis that the PCT originated in there and then jumped from ST555 into 7-PET. And so, for further detail, within the MDR PCT, there is a sub-element that's called ISCR1, which is located into the integron part of the transposon. It's a complex mobile genetic element. And so this ISCR1 element is the part that carries the beta-lactamase PER7 gene. And this was observed in other bacteria previously. It was observed actually in not Vibrio cholerae, but Acinetobacter baumannii. And those were isolated in different places, including France and the United Arab Emirates. And so, given the proximity between the Emirates and Yemen, there is potential for there was like some sort of connection between those beta-lactamases observed in Acinetobacter in the Emirates and the one observed on the transposon on the plasmid in Yemen. I'm not going to go into the detail, but the genetic structure of those elements suggests potentially that actually it will be like the element present on the Yemeni plasmid that would have occurred first and then was transmitted and jumped onto the integron present on the plasmid in the Acinetobacter from the Emirates. But it doesn't mean that there was a transmission from Yemen to the Emirates because, like, in this situation, we have a lot of unobserved data. Lots of evolution must have occurred, like with lots of intermediate bacteria, mobile elements, and so on and so forth, where things have combined and recombined. And we only have like a very small sample, anecdotal sample of what happened. So we really can't draw conclusions of what happened first and then. But like, there's fair evidence that they are connected. So here we can replace the presence and absence of those mobile genetic elements onto the tree of the 7-PAT-T13 isolates. So we can see around the tree the little bullets that represent the presence of those elements. In yellow, the MC-plasmin backbone, and in brown, the MDR-PCT. And we can see that it's mostly present in 2019 and late 2018 in the background H9G. And it's also present in one isolate of H9H, but that was also sampled in 2019. And then interestingly, we have at the top those isolates that were taken from Zimbabwe in 2018, and they have a different plasmid, but this plasmid has the same backbone. So different insert, different MDR region with a different antimicrobial resistance profile, but it's the same backbone. And so that leads us to consider the presence of plasmids in 7-PET isolates. So while they were common in wave 2 and wave 1 isolates, INC plasmids are quite uncommon in wave 3 7-PET isolates. In fact, in those strains, like the main source of antimicrobial resistance is usually like the presence of integrative and conjugative element or ICE, and typically like the SXT type of ICE. And so you can see that in wave 3 isolates, and more precisely in sublineages T8 to T12, all the isolates carry an SXT ICE, and very rarely so, they do carry also an INC plasmid. And really, like, it's only been observed in sporadic isolates, and it is thought that the Vibrio cholerae cells cannot maintain the INC plasmid, and potentially this is due to the presence of the SXT ICE, so potential negative interaction between those two elements. And so that's not true anymore with T13 because we have here two outbreaks that are quite sizable. So, like the Zimbabwe 2018 outbreak had 10,000 suspected cases, and of course, like the Yemen outbreak, if you consider only those from 2019, it still is more than 1 million suspected cases, and all of the isolates in those two outbreaks carry their respective plasmids. So here, there's no such rule as The plasmid cannot be maintained in presence of this SXT ice. The SXT ice is present, but what happens in T13 is that there is a deletion in the SXT ice, and so a loss of 10 kilobase pair, and that's the region that encodes the AMR. And so here we're in the situation where the INC plasmid, like sort of compensate the MDR phenotype that was lost through the deletion in the SXT ice, but also that suggests to us that through that deletion, maybe there was loss of some mechanism of inhibition of the plasmid that was encoded in the ice in that particular region, and that in the absence of that putative mechanism, the INC plasmid is able to be maintained in that 7 PET wave 3 background. And so with T13, we've got something new, which is the cohabitation of an SXT ice and an INC plasmid, and both potentially with AMR genes, and more likely MDR combo of genes. So to conclude, the Yemen cholera outbreak is the largest recorded in history, with now more than 2.5 million suspected cases. I'm sorry, I don't rely on the latest figures. I only have really the data up to the end of 2020. And that's already like an awful, horrible lot of people who were affected. And so it was caused by an epidemic strain of Vibrio cholerae, lineage 7 PET and sublineage T13. Other strains were isolated from cholera patients and also from environmental samples, but we think they are not causing cholera actually. And as if you think of what I said in the beginning of the talk, they don't have the genes that can lead to developing the acute watery diarrhea. So our hypothesis is that their isolation of those other strains, those endemic strains, is coincidental, because typically those Vibrio cholerae can be isolated from with the same media, the TCBS medium, that doesn't discriminate between endemic and epidemic. And so if you go out and sample water or stools, you will be able to actually isolate those endemic strains if they occur in the sample. And our hypothesis is that those endemic strains co-colonized the guts of patients that were already infected by epidemic 7 PET strains, and so those people who were infected reported to hospitals because they were having the cholera disease. But then, during the process of isolation, because both strains occurred in the samples, randomly, sometime it was the endemic strain that was isolated instead of the epidemic strain. And actually, we have evidence of this because we have samples where both strains were recovered. And in one case, both strains were cultivated, cultured at the Institut Pasteur. But we also have cases where, from the same original samples, we obtain a 7 PET genome from the genomic DNA sent to the Wellcome Sanger Institute, whereas from reculture at the Pasteur Institut Pasteur, it's the ST555 strain that was recovered. And so, concerning the 7 PET T13 strain, we have evidence that it diversified during the outbreak into several distinct clones or phylogenetic clusters. Those we called H9E to H, and then H9E was the one that dominated 2016. And 2017, and then 2018 was dominated by H9H, and then 2019 by H9G. And so in late 2018 and 2019, we have the rise of multidrug resistant genotype, which is due to the presence of an INC plasmid carrying multidrug resistance pseudocopan transposon or MDR-PCT. This was mostly present and observed in the H9G clone of 7PET-T13. However, there was what we think to be a spillover of this plasmid into diverse endemic strains, and we suspect the MDR-PCT to originate really in the ST555 endemic strains. And that the long maintenance and sustained presence of this INC plasmid in the 7PET genome may be due to a new molecular mechanism that is still unknown, but that may be related to the deletion in the SXTIs. And so I'd like to thank everyone who took part in this study, and starting by the teams in Yemen and in Sana'a in particular. So all the healthcare staff in the hospitals who collected all the samples for the early disease warning system, and I assume in very difficult conditions, so really grateful for them to have managed to do that. And then the staff at the National Center for Public Health Laboratories, NCPHL, for amazing work isolating the strains and then characterizing those strains, and so to provide a really like a solid basis for what we have done here. And also people at the Sana'a University who took part in the same tasks. And then like our different collaborators in this study, so from WHO, University of Toronto, so Bashir and Ghulam who took really care of managing to ship the samples from Yemen into Paris or in the UK, and then like the teams at Institut Pasteur and the Wellcome Sanger Institute for the genomic analysis. And thank you all for your attention.